any panel discussion may have motivated you in one way or another, and what the highlights might have been. Now, the only way you can do an effective takeaway is obviously to kind of get into it, pay attention, take a couple notes. Take those notes also as a basis for whipping together, so to speak, questions that you might have. Now, these people have taken some valuable time away from their businesses. And as you know, in business, time is money, so there's an opportunity cost that they're going to be here with us. So I think we owe them, don't we? Our undivided attention. Let's not be looking at anything. Let's put our cell phones away or anything that isn't pertaining to the class. Lock it up. I absolutely agree. You can go ahead and back and do what you want to do. That makes sense? All right? Okay. Well, it's my pleasure to introduce you to the panel that we put together. I'm going to start with probably the loveliest one of these. Let me introduce to you Eileen McCain, who is representing Northwest Mutual. This is an insurance investment financial services company. Eileen will give you a pretty good story of her background in just a second. Next, we have Matt Cirillo. Matt is the accountant for the Sheet Metals Incorporated. Sheet Labels Incorporated. Right up the road, man.
Well, we can use the gap. Bring lights on.
Bingo. All right, that's good for you.
Good for you.
Right. Matt's one of our former students and has done a great job in this new job. Next, we have Paul Down, CPA from Down and Riccadelli, the Limited Liability Partnership. He is one of our former students. We go way back, Paul and I, and he's got a great, great experience to share with us as well. And next is Kevin O'Brien from O'Brien Insurance, one of the leading insurance agencies in the area. Brian has been, Kevin has been a real advocate and supporter of the college for many years. So what we'd like to ask each of you to do is maybe share with us a little bit of your background, what you do, and so forth, and we'll start with you, I believe, if you will be so kind.
Okay.
Does it have to be on?
It doesn't have to be. You have a projector.
Really loud.
thanks for having me here.
My name is Matt Cerullo. I work at sheetlabels.com. It's actually our DBA. You guys will learn what that is in business world. Basically, I have a 2-year accounting degree from right here at Savannah Rondon. And I started actually, I did my internship for Savannah Rondon at this company. It was a small company in a small, pretty much a barn down on Bay Road, right down the road. And I just really focused on cost accounting, managerial accounting, which is kind of where a different place you can take accounting besides CPAs, which CPAs are great at taxes. I wanted to go a different way with it. I always knew that the good part of accounting, the reason to go into accounting is that there's going to be jobs. In a good economy and a bad economy, you can get a civil service job in accounting. I mean, there's lucrative opportunity in the field of accounting. And one of the biggest things that I had to get over when I was a student was the fact that accounting has a negative connotation at first. I mean, people think it's boring. People hear the word and they say, I can't believe you're an accountant. But really, if you get through that, it's really not, people are misinformed. It's actually can be really exciting. My job is awesome. I love my job. I focus on mainly making sure we manufacture sheet labels. So I make sure that we manufacture them as efficiently as possible. We have over 4,000 different types of label products, and I play a key role in deciding what we're keeping and what we're going to get rid of. It's just so much fun to go to work every day to actually see my results affecting the entire company. I think that's one thing that when I was in school for accounting, I didn't even realize what happened until I got out to the field, and then I realized that I can actually make a difference in this company, and everyone that works there can benefit from certain things that I'm doing. So that was something that I didn't even realize I was going to get out of this field. Just to give you a little background, before I even got into accounting, I had all kinds of different career aspirations. I was a music major for a while. Took psychology for a while. I really didn't know where I wanted to go, but I had some good professors in accounting, and they really kind of just painted it. It made it seem, first of all, not as difficult as everyone thinks it is. It really isn't. If you can get through the first semester of accounting, it gets a lot easier. So
good to hear, isn't it?
I'm telling you, just it's not that bad, really. Get through that first semester. Cost accounting, managerial accounting is, to me, some people, everyone's different, but to me, I always found that the managerial is a lot more relatable. If you've ever worked in retail or for any company, you can kind of apply the principles to anywhere you work and kind of see it in action. So, I guess that's really the story.
Okay, that's a good intro. We'll be back. Started here it was ACC, still hard to not say that. But I came from Saratoga High School, came up here for my 2-year degree, knew I wanted to be a public accountant, but that's really about it. Certainly with the great professors we had here and a little bit of discipline on their part to keep me focused. After my second year here, actually Castleton State in Castleton, Vermont, was looking to start their business division, and they came over and asked a dozen of us to take our third year here at ACC and only transfer for the 1 year over to Castleton. Certainly, as putting myself through school, that was certainly the way to go and save me quite a bit of money. So the dozen of us did that, and it was a great program. Stayed here for my third year, took the managerial accounting, took cost accounting, and I agree with Matt. If you want to kind of pursue the accounting degree or really anything in management, actuarial accounting and cost accounting can bring you a lot of in-depth knowledge that you wouldn't get from the basic accounting courses. So from there, I actually met a person in my cost accounting class that was a public accountant, wasn't a CPA. I sat in front of the class because I had to pay attention, and he sat in the back of the class. He was much older and I guess could get away with that. But got to know each other through the class and offered me a job. At the time, I was working 5 jobs to get through school. I needed to know what day it was so I knew where I was working that day. But needed to work full-time to put myself through school. So he offered me the job, and I could only take, only have to go one spot. I jumped at that. But really, that was an eye-opener, and you realize that after all this schooling, I was 2 years here at the time, I really didn't know anything. And so I had to do tax returns for businesses and individuals, and clearly I knew the forms, but they didn't give me the questions to answer. So you're kind of out there on your own trying to figure things out. So certainly encourage anybody that's going to go into accounting, if you get a chance to do an internship like Matt did, that's just valuable lesson to learn, especially during the summer if you've got the summers off. Internships are great. So anyways, I got that job, and then ended up working for 7 years for another accounting firm, and then decided at the age of 29 that I wanted to do this on my own, so I went out on my own. And then about 8 years later, decided to join the firm that I'm with now, and we merged back about 9 years ago. So again, it's all been here in the community, so it's been great. Got to know a lot of people. In 1994, I was asked to join the SUNY Adirondack Foundation Board. Of course, being a CPA, they wanted me to be treasurer, and I've been treasurer and president of that organization since 1994, and still am today. So, we monitor the scholarships and so on. So, the biggest challenge for us right now is we don't have enough students coming out of school that want to be accountants, so that we have a severe shortage of accountants. We kind of shot ourselves in the foot when we changed legislation here about 6 or 7 years ago that requires a fifth year of accounting to be a CPA. You don't have to have a master's, but you got to have 150 credit hours. So if that's the way you're looking to go, you better plan now that you've got to get your 150 hours in. So there's just a lot more that needs to be learned in that area. So that significantly decreases the number of students that are coming our way. Just as an aside, right now we've done 2 internships with SUNY Albany, about to stay in the SUNY system. Some good graduates, and most of the people are pursuing their master's degree as long as they got to do the 5 years. And so we've done a couple internships, and then we typically hire both of them. And then we've got a third one who's going to St. Rose right now at night to get her master's degree. 70% of the outstanding or the graduates graduating right now are female in the profession. It was 25% when I started the field. So you can see the progression there. And as I say, it's a great opportunity. It opens up you to running businesses. Most of the CEOs of companies now really have a financial background, more so than what it was before you were the entrepreneur. Now more so it's the numbers guy or gal that are running these companies because they need to make money. So great opportunities if you want to go into accounting, and I agree with Matt, you got to get through the first couple of semesters. It's a little bit easier after that once you get the basics. So be open for questions.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Kevin.
Kevin O'Brien with O'Brien Insurance, a local family-owned independent insurance agent down the street in Bay Street, just outside of downtown Glens Falls. Born and raised here in Glens Falls, went to ACC, Adirondack Community College, for a 2-year marketing degree. Transferred all my credits over to SUNY Rockport, out by Rochester. And again, the key on that was just that SUNY had all the credits, I didn't take any extra courses. Got out with a 4-year business marketing, business administration marketing. And great experience here. A lot of local business teachers here, then went to Rockport and had a lot of great teachers here. Also from Kodak and Xerox, one of the retired retirees. So both institutions gave me real life experiences to what to expect when you get out under mom and dad's out of their basement and got to fend for yourself on your own. So out of there, interviewed probably my senior year, probably did, you know, maybe 50 or 60 interviews, because in our quad, the contest we had was along the wall, we would hang up all the rejection letters that we got from our interviews. So I don't think I won that one. I think I probably had like 30 or 40 rejections. But what you want to understand, again, where you guys are at, again, do your 2 year, go for the 4 year degree. Great here on this campus. What you're always going to do is, you know, go up 500 feet and get your 4 year degree from SUNY Plattsburgh. I highly recommend that, again, from all of us here. You know, very cost efficient. You know the stats coming out where I think the average college grad is 28 or 30 grand in debt, or 40 grand, whatever. And again, on this address, you really don't have to go that route to be out of debt. Now again, we all should go away and get away from mom and dad every now and then, so I endorse that. But again, stick in the SUNY system, because again, the transfer credits will help you. You won't be doing the normal, even when I went with my kids a couple years ago, the average 4 year degree has taken 5.5 year degree or 6 years to happen. And it's kind of crazy these days, especially with the economy. So keep your costs, keep an eye on that, keep doing your summer jobs, do the interns. Whenever you can get any chance to do an intern, and there are lots of people in this area, go through Adirondack Chamber of Commerce. I know President Duffy is kicking off probably next year, hopefully, nice program with Mary's help and the business help to get this location to be known for an incubator for internships and also mentorships. You know, don't think you have to go out there on your own. You can hook up with, I'm a Rotarian, there's Kiwanis, Alliance. A lot of the business community want to give you some of our thoughts and ideas as you go through the college experience. One thing you also want to know coming out of here is, again, I think as we talked about before, diversification. You definitely want to come out with, you know, 5 or 6 different skill sets. You're going to be coming into a business where you're going to be pegged from off your resume, from your looks and all that kind of stuff. You want to come out of there and hey, maybe you took an EMT course. You know, maybe you're a volunteer fireman. Maybe you volunteer and come help Kevin O'Brien do taxes, which is not a bad thing. It's very easy to do taxes in the spring of the year. That really looks good, especially for your accounting folks. If you can go to Plattsburgh or CN or U of Albany and you've already done, you know, 40 hours of practical with doing free tax returns for those people who can't afford it, that's a thumbs up, and I think that would be well received by CPAs or any firms on that. So look at your skill sets, do your resume, see what jumps out on the resume for us employers. And again, biggest thing I'm looking for is, you guys all know the computer stuff and all that. You know, don't blow us away with all your computer skills. You just want to make sure you talk to us nice in English and tweet and all that kind of good stuff. You want to help us with our lack of computer skills to make our business grow. But more importantly, you need to be organized. Yes, you're going 4 different ways right now because you're listening to me, but you're also doing something in the back of your mind 3 different ways. What us employers are looking for is to give you a project, and hopefully you swim as opposed to you sink, because again, we want to encourage you guys to blossom, and either you're going to hang your neck or you're going to blossom and you're going to be promoted and then get on. And again, most employers are want you guys to succeed, so you've got to be very well organized. You can't be doing that, all that kind of stuff. You want to be able to assess what the issue is that your supervisor, your manager has given you. Come up with a game plan, sell it, and get the stuff done. But again, that takes real good organizational skills. People that I come through to try to interview, very hard to quantify their organizational skills. And again, with tablets, with phones, you can come up very easily on how to get your day organized. And as Nick said, time is of essence. You all get 8 hours a day. You're going to come into the job force, you're going to be expected to do 10 to 12 hours a day. So how can you use technology to make sure you get that 10 hours a day into 8 hours so you can go home and have a halfway decent family life? And last thing I'll say, because I'm a big promoter of it, and then on your resume, get out there and volunteer in your community, whether it's here or your hometown community. Get out and volunteer. That's a nice skill building set to have on your resume to see that you're well-rounded, because again, in the business community, many, many corporations are trying to be and do follow through on being a corporate citizen, where corporations are expected to give back to the community that they are generating their revenue from. So again, look at your local nonprofits, be the big brother, big sister, United Way, Kiwanis Rotary, whatever. There's a ton of, especially here in Bucks Falls, ton of local homegrown nonprofits that are just looking for, especially your techie, your tech savviness. Just come in and help do a website, do some video, do some Twittering, whatever you want to do. So that's my words. Thank you.
For me, it's really easy. I just simply, you mean for my business? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah. I have an accountant. I have a bookkeeper. They put it into QuickBooks, and it does its magical thing.
So, yeah.
Exactly. These guys know more about the details of financial stuff. Why don't you take a shot at that?
Okay. I agree. The number one software out there right now is QuickBooks. I think some of your classes, that's what you're going to learn about. I graduated before the PC was out, so I'm a little bit older than you guys. And we actually had to manually write a balance sheet and an income statement and what it meant.
Cash flow statements do that.
What's that?
They make us do that.
Do they? Okay. That's good.
And we need it.
Cool. And it balances, right? You got to have your assets. They really rely upon the computer to kind of create and establish what is done. What we need people to understand is how is that balance created inside that financial statement? And so that takes a whole different skill to look at how is it posted? Is it posted correctly? And in QuickBooks, there's many things, especially in the cost accounting area, that are kind of done behind the scene. If you don't know how to use the program, really can't tell. And then just trying to find errors or make it a little bit more difficult. You know, my first general ledger, when I had to prepare my first financial statement, was this that
Jesus Christ.
And, you know, we had to make sure of balance. You had to know how to use a calculator. That's a skill that some people don't have. And then, you know, you had to summarize all that information and put it in a proper format, of which most of that's in a textbook. But believe me, you know, they're changing the rules all the time, so it's something that you have to really pay attention to. And Matt kind of gets to do that every day, so that he can answer that one more.
Sure. Well, do you have another question?
What
yeah, it depends what, there's different, I guess there's a lot of different types of accounting.
Yeah, all this work on the broader scale, which might you need to go for the broker's account. Broader scale, the basis of this, you graduate, so you could get a college.
Well, I get, it's gonna depend where you, what type of field in accounting you end up in. But as, I think the biggest thing that you hit on before was organization, like Kevin said. It's good to be organized, especially when you're dealing with very important figures. I mean, my company, we do use a CPA that audits. So after I go through and make sure that everything looks good, get it looked at every year by a CPA, double checks it.
What's the CPA?
Certified Public Accountant. That's, I guess you'd say the cream of the crop for accounting. I mean, you take it all the way to, I mean, there's different fields. There's a CMA, which is a Certified Managerial Accountant. They're working on totally kind of different, take accounting and divide it into two different paths. And you end up at CMA. Or, I mean, there's definitely other places you can go with it. I don't want to oversimplify it, but there's hundreds of accounting fields. There's forensic accounting. There's accounting for governments, there's accounting for healthcare, not-for-profits. Depends, you've got a lot of options, so you should probably think about where you want to focus, and then you can focus, then you can find certain skills that would apply to that avenue of accounting.
I would suggest that you want to get into another part of the business curriculum. You want to get into marketing, you know, take a psychological course too, because again, remember, when you're in business, you're always selling. Always selling. I don't care if you're a CPA and all you do is review the books, review the numbers. You got to sell to make sure that you, you know, make that client. So marketing and selling, you guys got to nail it down. Go to all those one-on-one courses, get it nailed down. And again, trust me, you're selling every day. You're selling to your parents that, you know, you don't want to go to school. You're selling you need to get a car. So selling is inert, and just all depends on if you want to go to a class and figure out from the textbook if you're really going to be a good salesperson or if you're going to still be the same salesperson you are. But psychological stuff, again, that gets into buying habits, gets into how we all act and all kinds of stuff, sociological stuff. So that's in addition to your accounting, go out and round out and get your the regular business core stuff that they have here. That's for sure.
When I was here, I took, I was on the accounting track, but I also took management. Certainly, as you escalate in the CPA field, Certified Public Accountant, get yourself licensed. Most of my time now is spent advising clients. So I have other staff in my office that have prepared the financial statements. Now someone's got to sit there with the owner, analyze it. You know, if you're only making 20% on the bottom line and you should be making 30% industry-wise, what's causing the 10% reduction? And so it's analyzing the financial statements, understanding where all the numbers are coming from and what could be done differently. So it's, you're talking about flow of the work. It's not necessarily the financial transactions. And as I agree with Kevin, I have to sell services to my clients every single day. I have to sell them the fact that I know what I'm talking about. I've got to sell staff to want to come and work for us. I'm not necessarily comfortable in that. That's not really what I wanted to go to school for. I wanted to sit behind my desk and work. But that's just not the way life works nowadays. Computer skills, so essential. Understanding, and like we typically ask a few questions. What computer courses have you taken? Some people now know QuickBooks, and they say, well, I've done QuickBooks. Well, I can tell you know about that much in QuickBooks versus what you need to know. You really know almost nothing. Excel. A little bit different. You know, we have a ton of skills that need to be done in Excel and Word. You got to be able to know how to take a discussion, put it on paper, send letters to clients, send letters to IRS. You got to be able to type a reasonable correspondence. We get resumes, and the resume goes into that rejection pile before I even talk to the person because I think the resume is just atrocious. So you know, you have to look at that whole package that you're putting together. You know, when you do your phone conversations, we typically have a phone interview. Some people don't even pass that. So again, there's just a whole skill level that you just keep building. And the best thing to do is to really build on everything that you can possibly build from. Use mentors, internships, and everything. It's just a package when you come out.
What about
do an internal financial statement. With financial statements, you know, it comes back to your banking relationship for the most part currently. So it's based upon the fact of what the bank wants you to do. And they give you the deadline. And if they give you a deadline and you miss it, most likely they're going to be able to take the loan and call the loan, which can put you typically out of business. So it's making sure you meet your deadlines. If you miss your tax deadline, you're going to get fined. You're going to pay, you know, pretty significant penalty. If you don't file them in multiple years, you can end up in jail as the owner. Because ultimately, the owner is the one that's responsible. Payroll taxes, not having them paid on time. Someone like Matt, if he's got signature authority, he can be the one that's in jail and have to pay the fine, as well as the owner. So there are statutorily, there's a lot of things that can happen that you have to know what your liability is. But, you know, issuing stuff on time, filing on time, there's always severe penalties. A matter of making sure that you understand. A lot of it's communicating. I have financial statements that are done late, but we've called the bank, we've explained why, we have a presentation that we've done, we've given them a new deadline, we make sure we meet the new deadline, so it's not, you know, it's not the end of the world if something doesn't take place, but a lot of it's just good communication. Cool.
Yes,
nice amount.
When it comes to taxes, just two questions. When it comes to taxes, what schools are we going into? What degree would I want? What classes should I take that would, you know, maybe more lucrative, something that would maybe expand my knowledge on taxes?
Well, on the tax side, really, internships, very, very important. Just interviewed a gentleman 3 weeks ago that has a master's in taxation from SUNY Albany. So I said, okay, if you're filing a rental property, what's the form number? Didn't have a clue. If you file a sole proprietorship, didn't know. What form is depreciation on? Didn't know. And I said, okay, thank you, you're not the right person. And he had a master's in taxation, so he'd been to school 6 years, went into the field, and he couldn't tell you a form number, whether it was a business return or an individual. And it sounds kind of, you know, I guess minor, but, you know, I'm looking at how much time I've got to put into the person when I hire them. And when they come out, you can command pretty significant dollars, certainly more down in the Albany, New York City area than up here.
Yeah.
But when you come out, Nick kind of said it, you know, when you sit down at the table the first day, you got to make me money. And so the more you know, the less training I have to do, that means you're more valuable. I'm willing to pay you more than the person that has no idea what's going on at all. So in the tax area, if you want to specialize in the tax area, you really should get a master's in taxation. You got to take 5 years anyways. You might as well get your master's and command more dollars right from the get-go. But you need to get into a CPA firm and do taxes. You need to get in there and do it, whether they pay you $10 an hour, $15 an hour, that's not really what's important. What's important is you get in there and get some practical knowledge.
Sure.
And Kevin was saying, you can get into the VITA program and do individuals, you know, for free and help out senior citizens, great program. There's no reason you shouldn't be volunteering for that. But the internship, you know, with the CPA firm is really where you're going to get some of your good base knowledge. We have a couple every year.
I have one thing I want to add. So these guys all do, well, not you, but you're in insurance.
Correct.
Right, so today. These two primarily, they do the taxes. So there's different, if you go into a financial planning avenue for your career, just to let you guys know the education you'll need. So you could go, I mean, we have people that I work with who just have a 2-year, then we have people who have 4 years, some people have their master's, but how you excel once you get the position doing financial planning is you get certifications.
Right.
So, like, I'll study for 3 months for one test, and if I have, for instance, I passed my 63 and my Series 6. So those two certifications have now put me at a certain level where I could really go to whatever company I want to if, for whatever reason, I want to leave my current position. So the cool thing, I guess, in my profession is there's not, like, you have to go and get a master's. You people are the type of people where they want to do 120% in everything you do. So I think it wasn't necessarily anything, it's more qualities. So when I went to take the job, you have to fill out a culture index, which really dictates how your personality is, because if you're confident and you have shown education, they're really looking for the personality and how well you can communicate directly with people. Because, you know, if you're dealing with an average person who's working in, I don't know, as a nurse, that nurse has no idea what financial planning is. You have to educate and speak in plain English. So they just want to make sure, I guess, Katie, to answer your question, it's not any extra thing. It would just be that your personality aligned with your other qualities. That would be like hardworking, driven, wanting, you know, a really exciting life. I mean, in the financial world, for most of us, like I work for myself. If I don't work, I don't get paid. I don't go into work, I don't have a salary. So whatever I do, I get compensated on. So if, for instance, I went to work in a role where you kind of take a set salary, I'm going to get paid the same thing that the person next to me is going to get paid. I personally was more interested in working in a field where I can work, you know, give it 200%, and whatever I put in falls back on me. So if I don't work, it's on me. So I think if you're just kind of a really individualistic, competitive person who loves to talk to people and help people, then I think that it would really be a good career choice for anybody. I mean, the average statistics on the people who are worried about finances, it's like over 50% of people walk at night are worried about money. It's the number one reason people get divorced. It's unbelievable, right? It's just education. So, I mean, that's what you're providing. I don't know if I answered your question.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you.
Okay.
Another question we heard from the most.
So my role, so what I do is, when I first started, I took a job and to help individuals on an individual basis with their finances. So I sit down with people in all different fields, learn about them, figure out what their goals are, and then I help them get there. So for instance, if somebody wants to buy a house and they need a down payment, I'll help them get on a savings plan. I'll help them invest their money so that they have money in retirement. I help protect their, I do some sort of insurance planning. That most of my people don't do life insurance. But I'll help them protect their, what happens if for some reason you get sick and you're out of work until you're 65. Right? Let's say it's your first day on the job, you're 22 years old, right? And something happens to you and you no longer can work. Right? So I'll make sure no matter what gets in somebody's way, they can meet their financial goals. So that's really what I do. When I first started, you have to go out and find clients. So it's not like they say, okay, here's a book of 400 people, and, you know, here are all these clients, and it's not given to you on a silver platter. You have to go out every single day and find business. So a lot of people are nervous about that because it's a lot of rejection. How do you do that? So you just get involved. I mean, when I first started my job, they have you come with you have to do a project 200, which means you have to write down 200 people that you know, and then you go to them when you first start, and you just share with them what you're doing. And you're not assuming that Mr. Smith need your help, but you have a nice relationship with them, and you hope they can introduce you to people. So that's how you do it. You work on your whole network. You go out, you join chambers of commerce, you go introduce yourself to business owners. You're just every day, as some people say, hustling, right?
So you're in a commission with us?
Yeah, so I'm on a commission, 100% commission.
Really? So you charge every people a certain amount?
No, so I do insurance, that's a certain commission, and then
did you guys start off, how was it okay for you in terms of producing capital to start your business, continue your business, keep it afloat?
I'll go first. One of the things you'll find out in life is all you have is what you know and also timing. Those are two key factors that you should come out of this discussion with is getting a job is who you know and the timing. In my personal situation, again, graduated Brockport. My dad was an insurance agent, operated his own, founded his own business here in West Falls back in 1957. So the last interview I had was he had arranged for me to interview with Travelers Insurance down in Albany. I didn't get that job for about 2 months. I had gone and actually a short order for Perkins Restaurant in Rochester. So no thing or two about flipping pancakes. But anyways, coming back to answer your question, Dad got me into Travelers. I worked for there for about 12 years. Rose up, got a bunch of promotions. As you know, I have a big mouth, so therefore I made some people uneasy and couldn't go any higher up in the regime. So he made me an offer to come into his family agency. And basically I started out on the ground floor with him selling and, you know, taking care of the garbage and snow blowing, all that kind of stuff that small business owners have to do because there's no employee to do it. So just, you know, have produced, sold insurance policies. I sell auto and home and business and life insurance policies and just rise up the corporate ladder. And then when he wanted to retire, simply he offered myself and one of my brothers the opportunity to buy him out. So it's you know, timing, who you know, the connections, and that's again, back to my earlier message, it's the skill sets. Is you guys have to put down all the different skill sets and get out there, and we're talking about networking. The biggest thing going forward is, yes, you can do social media, you can do tweets, you can do Facebook, all the kind of great stuff, and you know, Facebook is nothing more than networking. You guys want to get out, you want to belong to the associations that are here, whether it's a business association or whatever, but get out, network, get to know people, put yourself out on the line, do some public speaking, because again, going forward, that's a real big skill set, especially in businesses, that you have to be comfortable standing in front of people and yakking away and you know, whether they listen to you or not, you just keep going, and you just have to have that comfort level. So.
Before you speak, Mr. Miller,
yeah.
You are in taxes, right?
Yeah.
Working with taxes on. Just want to add one small thing, because taxes are so tricky and it's hard, it's not easy to make mistakes are not tolerated sometimes.
Yeah.
Especially in taxes.
Another firm that she was ready to retire. I bought brought another partner in, and we bought out a bookkeeping and tax practice. And we, that was in 1988, and then went to the bigger firms and kind of went out that way. But really starting off, friends and family, and I, coming back to selling, you're selling every day. I'm not comfortable doing that. I'm not really comfortable public speaking. But as Kevin said, you really have no choice. I have to be in front, whether I'm in front of this group or I'm in front one-on-one with a client, you're selling something all the time. You kind of just do it, and then Nick keeps asking you. You can't keep asking, you keep doing these things, but you're great. It's just one more life experience. So, getting capital and coming back to the banks aren't going to give you anything unless you've got an asset, a building or some other, you've got a portfolio that Eileen's got for you, and you've got $100,000 in there. They'll give you a $50,000 loan against that, but they're not going to give you anything else. And so, you got to get yourself started, but really, it is hard work. And, you're working a lot of hours because that if I'm, like right now, I'm not making any money, and the only way I make money is same as Eileen's. I got to go back to the office and work until 8 o'clock. But it's fun. I wouldn't have any other way.
I have a question for Matt. Matt, you went from 2 years here at SUNY Adirondack to the position, right?
Yes.
Do you see that transition was an easy one for you? Are you comfortable with the skills you walked from SUNY Adirondack with, and was that enough to get you into the success that you are now?
Knowing people comes to mind. I guess I did my internship, and it was just like perfect placement. It was knowing people and timing. It was exactly that. I definitely feel like I was prepared to do what I needed to do at work, but it was kind of more about the relationship between the president of the company and the position I ended up in. He was just growing so fast in this company that he didn't have anybody that could pay attention to what I was paying attention to. Didn't really have a bookkeeping system. He didn't even know what most of his products cost. I don't know if he wants me to tell him. I stepped in there and I just did a lot of work. I just kind of put my head down. Kind of the opposite of your position. I'm in the office all day. I spend hours in front of the Excel spreadsheets to the point where I dream about them. But it's, to me it's different. I just sit there all day, listen to music, and plug away at some numbers. It's a different take on it, but I definitely feel like I was prepared, but a lot of it had to do with the relationship that I built up with the president of the company, and we're always in contact 24/7. He'll text me on the weekend, ask me a question about something that happened a month ago, and I'm there to give an answer. But I'm in communication with him as far as my education. We're growing so fast, we're so busy. We just moved from a 7,000 square foot facility to a 33,000 square foot facility. We just launched a new product line. We bought $1 million piece of equipment. So a lot's happening so fast, and I jumped in and I'm trying to hang on, but he knows that my goal is ultimately to go back and continue my education, and he's actually offered to chip in towards that. He just kind of like, he's not discouraging me, but we just have so much going on. But I guess to say, was I prepared? Yes, but certain things I wasn't expecting, and that's the actual effect of everything that you're doing. So when you're doing it in class and you're doing financial statements or making journal entries, you don't see anything. We try to give good examples with products and actual real life examples, but you don't see the effect until you see a whole picture of an entire company and the ins and outs. You know the people that are doing things, the machines that are producing products. When you actually see it, it makes more sense, and it's just a different feeling entirely. But I do a lot of things that we did here at SUNY Adirondack. I do bank recs every month. Journal entries, everything that I learned here.
spelling mistakes, in, especially nowadays with work with spell check, you can have the incorrect word, but you got to be able to at least spell it correctly. So if there's a bunch of errors on the thing, I have to have some other reason to really look at that resume. And you'd be surprised at the number of errors that you have on the resumes. One of the other key items on the resumes is I look at the, you know, how many jobs do you have? And I want to see the sequence from when you went from high school to college, where you went to college, how long did it take you to complete your degree? Because those are the types of things I'm going to ask you questions about in the interview. And if I start seeing gaps, then I'm going to want to know. And if I see too many gaps, you know, between your work history, I either, you know, a lot of times that's just a negative signal. So you want to kind of make sure you close that gap. Even if you've done nothing, you can indicate some things on your resume that you had to take care of your, you know, your grandmother, and you did it for 2 years. To me, that shows a lot of dedication, and that's important. And that kind of closes that and gives you the ability to kind of see the bigger picture. But some of the resumes that we get really are just plain sloppy. And it comes back to the organizational skills we've been talking about here. You're a professional when you're coming into this arena. You're holding yourself out as a professional, and you know, if you're real sloppy at it, you don't, you know, you're not going to get a lot of times you're just not going to get that chance at that first interview, and you're competing against a bunch of people all at the same time. So you got to put your best foot forward, and that resume is that first thing. The other thing is not just the resume; it's that cover letter and how it's sent to us. Some people have some really crazy internet handles and some of that stuff. And then nowadays, we go out on Facebook. As soon as we get the resume, we're out there on social media. We check everything that you guys have been doing. I want to know what you're tweeting, texting on Facebook, what you're posting. And if some red flags come up, we probably aren't going to give you a call.
So, for example, if I'm constructing my own personal resume and I worked with a retail company for like 1.5 years and I got an assistant manager position 6 months into working in that job, so that's something I should put in?
Absolutely.
I plan on working with that same company throughout my entire education.
Well, when I started out, I worked with McDonald's. For 2 years, we came up here, opened a South Bend Falls store, and that's what helped me put me through school, because they would give me the hours. But I ascended into management, made sure that was all on my resume, took some side individual small businesses, did the bookkeeping on the side, that was on my resume. Of course, he asked permission to do all that. So I just tried to compile as much knowledge as I possibly could, so that by the time I graduated from school, all my opportunities were open to me. During school, I did college work study. I worked for CPAs here in town. I worked for CPAs when I was in Castleton. Worked on the weekends, just, you know, gathering up as much experience as I could. And what we're looking at is are you taking responsibility? So the assistant manager position certainly is showing that that the employer thinks enough of you and you're taking that responsibility.
Okay. Yes, sir. So I'm a huge fan of the college stuff. So when whenever I come to college stuff, I say young people, just the way you have approached these things, like, how was you able to save your own money to make things possible?
For me, I didn't have any personal savings. I left my house when I was 18 years old, lived on my own, and put myself through my 4 years of school. Now, I know everything's got to be relative, but my total debt coming out of school was $7,000. I graduated in 1980, so you got to put that in perspective. That $7,000 would be worth $30,000 or $40,000 now. But my first job, I got paid $10,000 for this, for my annual salary. So, you know, I was almost a year's worth of debt for just college, and then I had to live. You're living on your own, you got to pay rent. And you know, my college loan payment was $81. That was tough to make. So again, you got to put that in perspective. So I didn't work just one job. Even when I did my accounting, I had to pick up side work. You know, I typically work anywhere between 60 and 70 hours a week. I've done it since I was 18. I had to go to work every day, that would be a problem. I go and enjoy myself, so.
Yes, sir.
Back to the resumes. You said that getting any kind of managerial experience might have gone under the board. What's the best way to indicate that? Should that be an entirely separate entry, or should that be a second entry for it?
Usually, again, you put down, Lake George Steel Company, and the bullet underneath that, deckhand, purchasing agent, manager, that kind of stuff. So it's underneath the title of the employee.
Kevin, how do you get new clients every day?
How do I get new clients? A lot of networking, things like this, but along the chamber, B&I, Kiwanis Brewery, we do a lot of social media. My brother does a lot of that stuff. So, and more importantly, it's the O'Brien name. We've been around since 57, so reputation have to hold up. We have cars that are wrapped, so a lot of those, that's really where we get most of our, when people call us for a quote, that's usually where they hear us from, is our vehicles that are out there. We do some advertising, the Chronicle and Postar, do some radio stuff, do some community radio ads, promoting other businesses, WCKM. So a lot of different, I'm a marketing major, so I'm always thinking about, how do I get in front of people to tell my story and help me out.
Well, once you sign them up, you've got the signage coming from them every month, right?
Yeah, there's a commission, definitely, yeah. So we have to continue to do the service and, there's an awful lot of competition. You got Geico, you got Progressive Insurance out there that, advertise that stuff, but we just have to make sure that we hold up our end of the bargain, keeping them happy and answering the questions about insurance.
It's an incentive, based type of industry. They don't sit there and wait for
advance people within the firm if they can communicate directly with the client. happy to have that work. The reality is you're not going to progress if you can't get there and deal directly with a client without somebody looking over your shoulder and cleaning things up, you know? And then the second thing, you know, talking about public speaking, I'd encourage you all to get involved with Toastmasters, right? We have a meeting today at 4:30 in room 114 of Eisenhart. A week from Wednesday, we have another meeting in Eisenhart 118. And it's a great opportunity because in the Toastmasters, we have formal presentations, and then we have impromptu, what's called table topics, where you're thrown a topic, you don't know what's coming, and how do you speak on your feet, right? Because that's another skill. You know, what you're talking about is making yourself more marketable. And you'll also hear more information on the VITA program, the Volunteer Income Tax program. That's coming down here. We're going to be sending some emails out on the opportunities to step up, because it's not just related to taxes. You know, we talked about, you know, obviously you're learning about tax forms and how to kind of process, but these are transferable skills to other things. Sitting down and explaining things to people, doing intake. You know, this is great experience on your resume, whether or not you're looking at taxes or accounting. Okay, so those are some of the things. And then the community service. We have people right here on this panel that are doing a lot of community service. You know, Kevin, of course, just won the Walter Juckett Award, right? Because he's out there every day making a difference in your community. And when you do that, you're connecting with other people. You're getting to meet them. Because we're talking about how do you network your business. It's about getting out there, meeting people, but also you do an awful lot through service. And those service opportunities, that volunteerism that I'm going to encourage you to do from now till you're done here, over these next couple semesters, get out there and volunteer, make a difference, help out with some of our local not-for-profits on their marketing, your websites, and things like that, because you're going to meet people. You're going to meet the person that's on their board, and they're going to say, wow, this person's giving up their time, and that's the kind of stuff that you can get on your resume as well. We have a great career services department that helps with resumes, so you can reach out to them, and they'll help you, because we really want you to go out and push the envelope and get some great relevant experience as you're studying here. So just a few things that I want to mention. Thanks, Matt.
As you can tell, Professor LePan's very passionate about resume building. She's having a workshop about this, so we'll take advantage of that. In like a minute or so, could you help us wrap up by giving us some encouraging words in the summary fashion of for these aspiring young business.
Do you think we could take one last question?
One last question.
This gentleman had his hand up.
Who's that?
This gentleman was
the
last one,
yes.
Okay.
The question was for Paul. You mentioned working like 67 hours a week. How do you stay sane if you have to do that? Like, if the balance is full and working at.
You said you were sane.
Yeah. Well, I think a lot of it comes back to, I'm not really sitting at a desk. Believe me, the years, like tax season, where you're sitting at the desk for 70 hours, you're really pushing it. But, you know, when I'm out at a client and meeting, you know, it's a different skill set. Your mind is working differently. So, you know, when I say I work about 70 hours a week, it's a wide variety of different things. Honing in on one thing, I know at my age now, I just couldn't do it. But, you know, now I get to do stuff like this, and, you know, I got a couple client meetings this morning. I was out of the office. I'll do a little bit of review of tax returns when I get back to the office. Signing, meeting with staff. I get to take care of all the HR issues inside the office, so that's always fun, and that ties up time. So it's a wide variety of what I'm doing during that period of time, so it's not, but it's still fun.
You know, I always think about getting the satisfaction you receive when you're doing something you believe in and you really want to serve people. It's called psychic income. Okay. And you can't buy groceries with psychic income, but it sure does make you, when you lay down at night and say adios and thanks somebody upstairs for all that you've been blessed with, when you look at that psychic income, you feel good. So I'm doing a good job of serving people. Folks, that's so much, you know, a part of getting into what you want to do and doing it well. Eileen, wrap up. What are your words of wisdom
here?
Yeah.
Well, thanks so much for having me, you guys. Number one,
have in the field of accounting, there's like so many different ones that you would be surprised by how much there is in the field of accounting. Business etiquette is very important. That's not just emails, that's how you appear in business too. So when you go to your interviews, try to look really, you know, on top of things. Don't, you know, just hygiene's important at interviews. Believe what I've said in lunch. See how it's spelled. I mean, I guess that's really all I have.
Okay, good word with that.
Thank you.